Yeah. Good morning. Good evening. Welcome to worship this 14th weekend after Pentecost. As we gather for worship this evening, we will turn our hearts to our gospel lesson, also our Old Testament reading today, and some of the responsibilities we have as a part of the body of Christ. Some of our God-given responsibilities of being a part of the church and of being a part of the family of God. So we'll hear some of the words of Jesus today and then meditate on that in our message. We'll gather for Holy Communion this week at the back of the sanctuary. A reminder, as you approach the communion table there, stop and pause as the elder invites you to take the body of Christ. And then what we've started doing last week, and so we'll have one of the elders and myself back there on each side of the doorway. And then after you've taken the body, move to the next available pastor or elder who will invite you then to pause and take the blood of Christ and give you the dismissal. So that'll be communion at the end of our service today. Those who are in the balcony, when they've gotten to the back and you can't see them anymore, you can come on down the stairs in front of the sound booth to the front of the table. That way we're not crossing paths in the back of the narthex. That's Latin for lobby, for those of you who don't know the word narthex. Other announcements for you. The office is closed on Monday, with it being Labor Day weekend. We do have our adult Bible class still on Sunday with Pastor Kip. The class said they wanted to have class this week, and so they're going to meet, but the youth education hour does not meet this week. No confirmation classes or Sunday school across the street. Those will resume next week. Wednesday, we do gather for Bible studies, the women at 9:30, the men at 9:30, also in the parish hall. So if you haven't yet taken an opportunity of any of those Bible studies, encourage you to check those out. I think that's all of my pre-service announcements. Please rise for the invocation. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we gather today for worship in the name of the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We remain standing for our first hymn. Thank you. God's beloved, let us come before God our Father with repentant hearts and confess our sins to him, asking in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that he grant forgiveness to us. For God's word says, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Together we confess, God of mercy, I know that I am sinful by nature. I sin against you in what I think, say, and do, in ways that I know and in ways of which I am unaware. Instead of lovingly confronting those who sin against me, I too easily give in to my sinful desires for retribution, gossip, anger, and hatred. I ask for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, to forgive me for this and for all the ways in which I have done wrong against you. Upon hearing your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God to all of you. By the command of Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together the collect of the day. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant to us, your humble servants, your holy inspiration, that we may set our minds on the things that are right, and by your merciful guiding accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament reading for the 14th weekend after Pentecost is from Ezekiel chapter 33. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 13. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? The doer is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For the same reason you also pay taxes. For the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them. Taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the gospel reading. The gospel reading comes from Matthew chapter 18. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. Whatever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world for temptations to sin. For it is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. And if your hand or your foot cause you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven, for the Son of Man came to save the lost." What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 in the mountains and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that even one of these little ones should perish. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen, even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In response to having heard God's word read, we join together in professing our Christian faith this evening with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Hear again these words of Jesus this evening. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Here ends this portion of our text. Grace, mercy, and peace from our God and Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, I'd like for you to picture, I know it's going to be hard since you don't get to watch Husker football on TV yet, but I want you to just picture in your mind a football game. And now, they got a football at least, and they got their, you know, shoulder pads and helmets on. Well, one other piece of equipment without it would make that game really kind of strange, tough to follow. Kind of like the sermon so far. Tough to understand what's happening. Scoreboard? Aha, I've worked lots of games without scoreboards. We don't even know who's winning. Imagine if all of a sudden your team ran the ball 25 yards down to the 30-yard line, you stop there, and then all of a sudden they're running it back there to the 40-yard line on the other side of the field again. And nobody told you why. What piece of equipment am I referring to? Ye old penalty flag. You got to have one of those. Without that penalty flag, we don't know what's going on. Why are we moving the ball? What happened? Well, if you had watched a football game prior to 1941, you would not have seen a penalty flag. That's exactly what would have happened. Your team ran the ball, and they brought it back, and nobody told you why. Until a coach in Youngstown, Ohio, had the brilliant idea, hey, what if they threw a flag on the field to say there was a penalty? And so was born the penalty flag. Now, you've probably had some similar situations happen in your life. Maybe if you have a spouse, your spouse has gotten upset with you and you didn't have a clue why. And you asked, what did I do? And they may have said, well, if you don't know, I'm not telling you. How do I fix the problem? How do I get better? Or maybe you're a child with a parent who would get upset with you. What did I forget to do? You know. If I knew, I wouldn't say, what did I forget to do? You see, it's terrible when we don't know how we've gotten ourselves in trouble. We don't know how to avoid the trouble, how to get ourselves out of the trouble. We don't know how to make sure it never happens again. It'd be really difficult if instead of pulling you over and giving you your speeding ticket, they just took down your license plate number and mailed it to you, kind of like those traffic cameras. And then it's 2 weeks before you know you did anything wrong. Now, I tell you these stories, dear friends in Christ, to highlight what Jesus is talking about in our gospel lesson today from Matthew chapter 18. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. Tell him what he did. Tell him what was wrong. Tell him how he has sinned against you, how he has broken the relationship that existed between the two of you. Go and tell him. Why? Well, maybe he didn't even know. If you read this whole chapter and keep it in context, the whole purpose is that forgiveness might rule and reign. Why go and tell your brother his faults? So he can repent of his sin and receive the forgiveness of Jesus. Now, easier said than done, right? How many of you really enjoy a good conflict? How many of you go out of your way to initiate a conflicted conversation on a regular basis? I see no hands raised. How many of you would really appreciate it if somebody would come and start a conflict with you? Okay, Jerry volunteers. Everybody go talk to Jerry. Okay? You see, we really try our best to avoid conflicts. We try our best to keep things kind of hush-hush and not talk about our conflicts and avoid them at all costs. Because, well, kind of we've been, unfortunately, I think, mistrained by the society we live in, by the world around us, by this sinful world, to avoid conversations that are going to strengthen our relationships. And conflict exists to strengthen relationships. I get to tell you a story of conflict from my own marriage. It's one that I tell every married, pre-marriage couple I visit with in pre-marriage counseling, and so my wife doesn't mind that I tell this story. First year we were married, I made supper, and she was working hard. I was a seminary student, not working at all, and so she came home from work, and I had made dinner, the very best tuna casserole you've ever had in your life. And I made it just like my mama made it, with the peas and stuff mixed right in the tuna casserole. And we sat down at the kitchen table. I was so happy. I was so excited. I made an amazing dinner. I was going to treat my brand new lovely wife. And she sat down and she made a noise. The noise was, ugh. And the look on her face matched the noise. Now I'm trying to replay, okay? Not her anniversary, not her birthday, What did I do wrong? Now, most of us, in most of our relationships, that's the end of the conversation. Ugh. Eat my tuna casserole. Now, let's just hypothetically think for a moment. What would have happened that day had my wife made the noise and I asked, what's wrong? And she said, oh, nothing. What would have happened the next Tuesday when I made tuna casserole again? And again, and again, and again. For how long have we been married? 16 years? Who's counting? I imagine she would have got a little more, ugh, over the tuna casserole. Turns out she prefers it with the peas on the side, not mixed in together. Thankfully, we had a conflict the first time, and I don't make tuna casserole anymore with peas inside of it. Because a conflict now has kept us from 16 years of conflicts. Jesus tells us, dear friends in Christ, it is our responsibility. Even you might say an obligation, a command that comes from Jesus. If your brother sins against you, go tell him his fault. Don't pretend it didn't happen. Don't ignore it. Don't just expect them to know what's wrong. Go and tell your brother his fault. Why? So we can repair this relationship. So we can repair the brokenness. I do have one problem with the way Jesus says that in Matthew 18. I have one problem the way he says it. It's best expressed by, I read a blog by a Pastor Palmer. I can't pronounce his last name. It looks like chicken, but that's not how he's pronounced it, I'm sure. He's lead pastor at a church down in Arizona, and he tells a story about a time he went whitewater rafting in Zimbabwe, and the guide of their tour group told them, when your raft flips over, don't try to swim to shore. Just float down the middle of the river. Yeah, it's choppy. That's kind of, you're going to want to swim towards the smoother, calmer water on the side. Stay in the middle channel of the river until you reach one of the safety lines that crosses the river. And he asked his guide, why not swim to the side? Because that's where the crocodiles are. Good idea. But notice how the guide put it, when the raft flips over. See, that's what I wish Jesus would have said in Matthew 18. When your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. Because there are a whole lot of sins in every one of our relationships we have with other people. Whether it's a child or a spouse or a parent or a coworker or a friend or a driver on the street. There are a lot of relationships we have, and all of them are going to have sin invading them in some way, shape, or form. And the best way for us to keep that relationship strong and Christ-centered is to do what Jesus says to do. What does Satan want to accomplish in our lives? He wants to divide. He wants to separate us from each other. He wants to break apart those Christian relationships. He wants to keep us from loving each other. And he is so good at what he does. He has convinced us that it's more loving to ignore the problem and hope it goes away. He has convinced us it's more loving to my neighbor not to tell them they've sinned against me. It's more loving to just let that boil up inside with anger and hatred that I'm never going to be able to express until I just snap. But at least my neighbor thinks I love them. That's not Jesus-like. That's not Christ-like at all. Because what happens as that sin sits in our gut and we didn't tell our neighbor, and it just sits there, and it starts to fester, and it turns into gossip, turns into negative emotions, thinking poorly of somebody and maybe even spreading rumors about them, trying to tear them down and get them back for how they've hurt me. Make them feel worse and never know why. Jesus says, when your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. And if he listens to you, you've won your brother over. If he listens to you, you've won your brother over. What a beautiful statement there. If he repents of his sin and you give him forgiveness, you can imagine what's happening in the kingdom of heaven. Angels are dancing. Another sinner has repented of sin and a relationship's been restored. God is happy. And if he won't listen, Jesus says, now you can kill him. No, that's not what Jesus says at all. Jesus says, all right, now tell one or two others. Get a couple of people together. And now that small group of people, go talk to him. Why? So I can get my posse to come and attack you. That's why. No. So that we can maybe recall this brother to repentance. And when I tell this lesson in confirmation class, I also add a little more. And I tell my two friends over here, hey, we got to go talk to this guy because there's a sin that he sinned against me and we got to confront him with it. And I tell them what the sin was, and they may say to me, you know, I don't think that was a sin. I think you've wrongly accused him. Hopefully, then I go, whoops. But maybe they agree, my brother has indeed sinned against me. And the three of us go, for what purpose? That my brother might repent, and they might receive forgiveness. And angels might dance, and God is happy. What if he doesn't listen? Now Jesus says, tell it to the church. Now that doesn't mean stand up like in the middle of church on Sunday or Saturday night and say, my brother has sinned against me. We've got protocols in place to handle that. So, you know, just talk to pastor or one of the elders. We can take care of things. Tell it to the church, he says. Why? Because the church deals in grace. The church deals in pointing out where grace is needed and where the law is needed. And when to give grace and when to withhold grace. And tell it to the church so that the church can confront your brother and call him to repentance. And if they repent, there's forgiveness and angels are dancing and God is happy. But what if he won't listen to the church? Now Jesus says, treat him like a Gentile and a tax collector. What does this mean? Now we can kill him! No! What do we do for Gentiles and tax collectors? We evangelize them. We pray for them. We send missionaries to them. We reach out to them with the gospel of Jesus in hopes that the Holy Spirit will reach into their lives and convict them to repent of their sin and to come to Jesus. The whole purpose of Matthew 18 is for the advancement of the gospel, that through forgiveness, life reigns in the church and in the world. That our relationships, rather than being divided and torn apart and broken by sin, compounding sin, compounding sin, would instead be repaired through repentance, confession, absolution, forgiveness, and life. When someone sins against you, it is your Christian obligation. If you don't like it, read Matthew 18. When someone sins against you, it is your Christian obligation to confront them, to initiate the conversation, mano a mano, one to one. You have sinned against me. Dear friends in Christ, it's about the hardest thing to do. Matthew 18 is the right thing, not the easy thing. It's the correct way to handle disputes among us. It's not the funnest or most attractive or easiest way, but it's Christ's way. Ezekiel tells us, if I give you a word of warning, O son of man, that's how he addresses Ezekiel. If I give you a word of warning and you refuse to warn the people, they're going to die in their sin. But he kind of says to Ezekiel, Ezekiel, I'm going to hold you accountable for it. Those are some harsh words that God gives Ezekiel. I had a friend, our first year at Concordia Chicago, they were doing a construction project on a portion of our campus, and it kind of became the cool thing to jump over the 8-foot fence and take pictures in the construction site. It's a big no-no. Don't do that. They have signs. Stay out. Caution. Danger. Warning. But this friend of mine decided that was the cool, fun thing to do. After the next day, after they had done their picture taking fun times, sitting at breakfast, this was a regular occurrence, Wednesday mornings, I would have breakfast with this friend right before my class. 8 o'clock class is a terrible idea. But anyway, and we're having breakfast there, and she tells me about this, and I just, like, that's stupid. Okay, maybe not the best wording. Like, that's stupid. And you're breaking the rule. You're breaking the law. Don't do that. Trying to be a good friend, guess what it got me? I got to wear Lucky Charms to class as she threw her bowl of cereal at me, and we never spoke again. I lost a friend. It's not how it's supposed to go, right? We're supposed to, confront your brother, they repent, there's forgiveness, and the relationships are restored and rebuilt, and everybody's happy. Sometimes in our sinful world, that's not what happens. But Christ calls us to do what's right, even when it's not easy, even when it's not fun. That's what Jesus did. As Jesus is hanging on the cross, bearing in his body every single one of your sins, everything that every one of us has ever done against God, everything that anybody who has ever lived has done to violate God's commands, he's hung there on the cross, and he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He brought the complaint of sin straight to God himself, and he died. But in his death, in his resurrection, we see the restoration of the relationship between God the Son and God the Father. And all of those who have been crucified with Christ through the waters of holy baptism find our relationship with God fully restored. And that means our relationship with one another. Baptized, crucified, and resurrected. We have peace with one another and peace with God through sin forgiven. May the peace of God, which passes all of our understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the prayer of the church, each of our petitions ends, Lord, in your mercy. Congregation responds, hear our prayer. Please stand for prayer. Blessed Lord, you have promised that where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of them. So hear the prayers of your people and grant our supplications. O Lord, grant to your people courage, that with boldness we may speak your name in witness and warn sinners, so that they may come to faith and repentance and so enjoy the forgiveness of their sins. Give your church wisdom and strength by your Spirit, that she may be steadfast and unmovable in your word and truth. Lord, in your mercy, O Lord, be present among your people to serve us with the gifts of your grace, and grant that we may receive them with joy. Give us faithful pastors and church workers who will minister to us in your name and strengthen our faith and life together as your baptized people. As our congregation seeks to call an associate pastor, send your Spirit on the members of the call committee to serve with diligence, and upon the pastors being considered, that in all things your church here and around the world be continually blessed. Lord, in your mercy, O Lord, give to us good and honest leaders who will govern according to your word and will. Give us grace that we may not fail to pray for those who lead us and to act as good citizens and good neighbors to one another. Give peace to the nations. Bring an end to violence, prejudice, and racism. Guide us to know and respect all life, from the infant in the womb to the youth beginning maturity, and from the mature to the aged. Lord, in your mercy, O Lord, you send rain upon the earth and turn the seeds into plants rich with fruit for harvest. Accept our thanks and praise for your continued goodness in providing a good harvest and food for all. Give us wisdom so that we may use your resources wisely and extend your care to those in need. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you are the strength of the weak, the healing of the sick, the comfort of those who grieve, and the peace of those near death. Hear us on behalf of those listed in our worship folder for Millie, for Randy and Eileen, for Colton, for Taylor and Karen, for Vinny, for Ardith, April, Lisa, Jerry, and Mike, and for all others who have need, who are known, who we name before you in our hearts. Grant that they may be sustained in their afflictions, comforted in life and death, and delivered to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, teach us to forgive others as you have forgiven us, and bless the fellowship of the forgiven, that we may be united in doctrine and life. Bless us as we commune today upon the body and blood of our Savior, and help us to keep in holy lives what we will receive upon our lips in this holy sacrament. Lord, in your mercy, O Lord, deliver us from pandemic and pestilence, from disaster and danger, and from sudden death, that kept in faith we may be preserved through this mortal life, and in death be received into the arms of your mercy and of the blessed rest of everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear us, O Lord, who cry to you in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, whom with the Spirit you are one God and one Lord, now and forevermore. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. When he given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink of it, all of you. This cup is new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated and welcomed to the Lord's table.
The hands that serve, the wine and the bread. Oh, your love.